Hi there, this is Dan over at Lion Tower Miniatures. I've just set up a Patreon account and I'm going to be sculpting some miniatures for all of the backers. I haven't actually got a poll up just yet, so there's no kind of voted responses. However, I'm going to do a figure for Patreon backers to download already. This one is going to be Spearmaster. I'm going to go female on this one, and it's going to be in a style of Final Fantasy Dragoon type character, light armour, possibly some dragon or lion theming going through. I haven't quite worked that out yet, I'll concept it on the fly, so you may see me kind of sculpt something and then delete it, but obviously anything to do sculpt I'll be saving anyway, so I'll go into the Patreon library. I'll talk my way through, and if anybody has any questions afterwards, post them on the comments and I'll reply as soon as I can. So I've already started with a mannequin, straight out of ZBrush. The spear that I've put into the file already is a placeholder. I'll probably end up changing that before the end. It is actually one of the Patreon downloadable items, so if you're on the level 2 pledge, I think it is, you can download the spear. So yeah, get stuck in, download and drop it into your models if you like it. Just give a quick whiz around the model. So it's got a fairly feminine pose already. I'm not going to change that just yet. So the next thing to do is to make this into a skin. I'll just go down to my adaptive skin menu, click make adaptive skin, and I just need to change my tool. So first I'm going to just go to my spear on the subtools menu, and I'm just going to copy that because it won't be in the skin file already, this one. So I go to skin ZV1, it tells me it's obviously it's the same tool but it's been skinned. You'll see there's no spear there, but the poses, everything. The coloration on these now, ZBrush has applied poly groups to everything, so everything is kind of a separate object at the moment, so I can merge it all together or I can keep it separate and work on it separately. I will be merging it all together for the purposes of actually fleshing it out and sculpting the body shape and whatnot, and then we'll go and get the armour and everything designed, built and applied, and go from there. Okay, so I just click on the paste button down here on the right hand side, it's just slightly off screen for you, but it is in the subtool menu just next to the copy button. So click paste on there and you see it just drops the spear straight back in. It's worth knowing about that one because it does literally put it in the exact same place as the original where you copied it from. So if you've positioned something and you realise you've done it in the wrong file, it's always worth just copy paste, dropping it over the other side. Next thing I'm going to do, I'm just going to run down and just dynamesh the active tool, which is the mannequin. And this might take a couple of goes to just get right. No, it's gone first time, that's okay. So now I'm just going to go and put the clay brush tool on. You'll notice I'm not going to be sculpting this with symmetry. I will do the head with symmetry and then break the symmetry afterwards, but I find if you sculpt with symmetry on, everything looks a little bit off. And then when you come to pose the model, because you've sculpted it symmetrically, you end up having to deform all the joints and then re-sculpt them anyway, so I just find it's kind of a quicker process for me, at least, if I do this. So I'll just put the clay build up tool on. Just on standard settings, I haven't changed anything, just made the size a little bit bigger. And I'm just gonna turn my polyframes off for a minute just so I can see what I'm doing a little bit better. So I'll just go through there and I'm just gonna go over all the ball joints, get rid of all them because they look nasty. And they're not going to be required in the end piece anyway. bit of an indication of a bum cheek in there. And same again. Now, I haven't actually got any reference on hand at the moment, so this is going from memory, which is not necessarily the best way of doing it. I think my hip here is a little bit too far forward, so I'm just going to grab the move tool and just going to bring that back just a touch. But to be honest, although I'm fleshing out a little bit of the body and everything here at the moment, it's not actually required because I'm going to be putting armour on it, so by the time I've got all the armour and everything in place, the mannequin's more of a kind of placeholder for the pose. So if there's no meat on the bones, unless part of the anatomy is actually visible on display, which obviously generally is the case with female miniatures, but I'm going to avoid it on this one, then you probably get away with not doing any of the anatomy, dropping my T's. My wife's a teacher, she'd shoot me for broadcasting it with poor grammar. Okay. So you see, I'm not really affecting an awful lot at the moment. I'm definitely not changing any of the proportions. The mannequin itself, the proportions are set, but it's not the most chunky of characters. If you're doing like a big bulky male, obviously you start having to slap down loads and loads of kind of bulk onto the thighs, you know, broaden the chest, all that kind of stuff. But for what I'm doing here, I'm just going to leave him with her rather. Fairly unscathed. Now, just to give you the indication of where I'm at here, so I'm going, there is the top of the ribs. And there's the hips. Hold Alt and just drop a little bit of a negative in, so I'm just going to carve into it a little bit. If I do any shortcuts or anything, I will kind of talk you through. I'm sure anybody who's used ZBrush for any amount of time is going to be fairly familiar with most of the quick keys. And obviously what I'm doing here is not necessarily the right way of doing it. It's just a way that, you know, I've developed myself. Had no formal training in this, so this is all me just, you know, doing what instinctively feels right. And sculpting a miniature this way as well, without the symmetry, is very much more like what you would be doing if you were sculpting a physical miniature in there, like green stuff or Fimo or any of them. So obviously you have to set the pose before you start sculpting. Obviously one of the benefits of digital sculpting is that you can turn the symmetry on and save yourself a ton of time. I've obviously opted to forego that benefit. However, I'll be benefiting from it in other ways later when I already have with the spear, I suppose. You recycle tools or you use template components, and you know, you can do all that kind of stuff in a physical sculpt as well, don't get me wrong, but it's just much easier and quicker to do trial and error in digital format. Just smooth it all off, holding shift to bring the smooth brush in. I'm not going to touch the feet, I'm literally just going to sculpt the boots for them, I think, and just replace them, because they're not going to be on display, I'm not going to be using them. Same with the hands, the stumps that are there are placeholders, they'll stay as they are, but I won't be doing any kind of significant sculpt work on that. Again, I've got a couple of tools which I have put into the Patreon library at the £10 pledge level, and the tools are kind of a fist hand and an open palm hand. So the open palm hand is not very detailed at all, but I use it as a placeholder, as a starting point. The fingers are separated, so you can isolate the fingers individually and kind of bend them and pose them as you like. And the fist one is obviously, you know, quite often when sculpting miniatures, they're going to be holding a sword or a spear or something like that. So you want a clenched fist. And yeah, you could use programs like Daz or Make Human and kind of, you know, do all the posing in there. But those models are actually designed for 3D work. This is 3D work, but they're designed for like computer graphics and artistic renders and game characters and that kind of thing. And the problem you'll find if you try and use them for miniatures is that the digits on the fingers are too thin. The the actual thickness of the hand isn't right, and if you put it on in a realistic proportion as well, it looks really weird. It doesn't work as a miniature properly. I have tried it myself in the past, when I first started out doing digital sculpting. You're kind of going, hey, here's a ready-made person, why am I messing around sculpting anatomy? We're going to just go. Don't be tempted to try it. It is cheating. You know, it's good as a point of reference, I suppose, but nothing's going to beat actual, you know, proper sculpted reference and photographic reference and whatnot. And you benefit more in the long run by actually doing it yourself. So you're just cheating yourself in the long term if you actually do use a prefabricated base mesh. So it's worth, I mean, I have built base meshes myself, and it is worth doing. It's worth doing from a practice point of view as well, just because, like I say, it's not often when you sculpt a miniature you're going to have the full anatomy going on a display. So the temptation is to not sculpt it all. Let's go to the move tool and just adjust the bum cheeks here, because this looks a little bit off from the side. A bit pointy at the top, so should give it a bit of smoothing over. Because if you're honest, everybody's going to want at least a nice bum on a model. And probably some, like, you know, proper badassery here and there with death stare and a killer pose and whatnot. But you know, when you're sculpting a woman, and then you get into the whole just topic of sexist portrayal and whatever else, but it's going to avoid all of that by, not my kind of thing anyway, so I never get the old chainmail bikini type setting and scenario, so I'll be steering well clear of that in all of my sculpts. Unless obviously you guys on the Patreon decide that's what you want, and then I'll have to negotiate with you. Okay, I'm going to leave that for now. Fairly happy with the proportions there. Not perfect, but it doesn't need to be. Let's drop it in back in the centre. The frame button there on the right hand side, that will basically just drop. If you tap it once, whatever you've got as the active tool fills the screen from top to bottom. If you tap it a second time, the entire miniature or the entire sculpt, including all of the subtools, are active. That will fill the screen as well. So just before I carry on, I'm just going to load in another subtool. Now this is, well, the two I'm going to drop in. So the first one is something that a sculptor called Bobby Jackson, he sculpts for Reaper, very well known name in the miniatures game, kindly donated to me. And it is a, I'll find it. Awesome. doing the wrong thing again. Okay, it's actually a, there you go, millimeter ruler Bobby Jackson. Okay, so this thing is literally what it says on the tin. It's not straight because I'm knocked it up, so let me just straighten it a little bit and rotate it back around. Okay, so it's a 50mm ruler. Obviously it says do not print ruler on the side there. Basically you leave this in the file right to the very end when you do your STL, when you do your print export, and it helps you to gauge how big the model is going to be. So this one I'm going to do 32mm from there to this point right here, where the eyes would be. So you're probably talking about 35-36mm to the top of the spear. It's not a bad scale, it's a good one to work with, and obviously if anybody's looking at this and you're not a miniature sculptor, you're going to be looking at this kind of going, why the hell is that spear so huge and fat and chunky? And it is obviously because it's going to be 32mm tall when it's printed. If you were doing something 54mm or 75mm, you can obviously scale that down, and you can make it thinner. You can, you know, like streamline the shaft a little bit, make the blade thinner and look more blade-like. So there are things you can do. You just need to obviously kind of consider the scale you're going in at, and how you want to approach it. Okay, so I suppose let's work out the armors, how I'm going to do the armor on it. So I'll go to a sphere, and it's a bit of an odd way of doing it perhaps, but I'm going to turn symmetry on for this. Obviously it's armor, it's a fixed plate, it's not going to deform like human muscle and human tissue. So I'll turn activate symmetry on. I only want the X on, to make sure I'm on the right side. So there we go, so this is my X axis here. So you see, if I just if I put a tool on here, make polymesh really, sorry. So if I put a tool on here, still haven't turned transform on now, I've got to turn it back on again. Anything I do on one side happens on the other side as well. So I'll just undo that, and the first thing to do is just rough this into shape. So I'm going to bring up where the shoulders are going to be, push the back in. And again, I'm not holding alt or anything, this is just the standard move brush, just using it to deform the figure a little bit. So bring the size in. Okay, now I'm just going to quickly minimize this down to about 97. Let's get it back in the center of the frame. I'm going to hold control to set my mask tool. I'm just going to rough that out, control and alt will turn it around the other way. This is going to create a collar, so what I'll do now is I'll just invert that by, while I've got the mask control button, I've got the mask tool done, you tap off the model just once and it'll just invert it. And then I'm going to click on the move transpose tool, hold shift while I'm any of the hotkeys I press, you'll see them appearing in the top left corner. So if you're wondering what I'm doing to affect this all, you'll see the things happening. So holding shift basically makes it go, if you look at the side, it makes it go completely straight. So if I do this now, I can go like that. If I hold shift, it's going to snap at increments, and it's always going to be going vertically up if I just get into the right position. So while I'm holding shift, I click on the middle part and you drag it up like that, and you see it's just deforming all of the polygons and it's making it look ugly and everything else, but it's you know, it's only a rough form at this point, so it's not the end of the world. I'm going to dynamesh all of this in a bit anyway, so that's not going to make any amount of difference. So hold control and drag, which just clears the mask, and let's just go down and get this dynameshing done. So go to my geometry tab on the right hand side. Just again, apologise, it's just ever so slightly off screen. If I push my key, push the monitor back. Okay, so you can see it down here on the right now. So you've got my, you probably can't read it, but it's the Dynamesh button there. So I've got polish I'm going to turn on. I'm going to turn project off because I don't really need it, and all it does is it really does make it take a lot longer to process. I'll leave blur on a little bit. I basically just like blends all the edges away, and then I'll just dynamesh at the resolution it's at the moment, and this might go horrible and pixelated. No, it's actually okay. Sometimes when you depends on how big I think it is, this model is in the viewport. So if you look at the base here, you've got the grid there. If that grid's really tiny, like you're out here somewhere, and you do something like 128 resolution on your dynamesh, you're going to end up with a really blocky pixelated model. You're really going to have to scale that resolution up. So at the moment I've got it 128, and it's 50,000 active points on this one there. Obviously if it's a lot larger, you do the same level of dynamesh, you probably still end up with 50,000 points. But it's 50,000 points on a much larger object, which obviously is not going to look half as nice. Okay, so I'm just going to get this now. Let's import this straight into the model. No, I won't. I'll carry on building it here. Do something quite odd looking now. I'm going to go to mesh insert dot. It's a funny looking tool because it's got points and stuff all over it. Now often if you hold the M key, it'll bring up, if there's a multi-tool, it'll bring it all up. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to draw the breasts in there. So go to about there, I think. And they're not going to stay like this, so don't worry about looking like, you know, ridiculous cartoon, over the top style one. So let's just drop that down to there. And the reason for doing an insert, you could create a separate sub-tool, but I'm literally just going to re-dynamesh this now. So you just, with the dynamesh already set up, just drag the mouse, drag the cursor. And you'll see now, if we go to the poly tools, it's a separate poly group, but you can see like the polygons are all blended in, so everything's all part of the same. And it just makes it nice and easy. So let's turn this off because it's awful to try and figure out what you're doing on that. That's going to drop a little bit of bit of blending in through the top. Again, do be mindful that this is going to be an armoured surface by the time it's finished. They're going to be light armour, but it's still going to be metal. Possibly some leather. A combination of both, I think, might be quite nice. So, you don't want to leave all of the tool marks on the surface. I'm just smoothing it all off now. Let's come around here as well. Let's just do the same. I'm going to use this tool called H-Polish, which I've got over here. I've got it set as a quick tool, but again, it's you press your brushes, you press H, and it's like kind of down. Where are we at? I'm not pressing H, by the way, because I'm using the Cintiq Companion, and I've got the quick keys, but I've got no keyboard apart from an on-screen one. If I put the on-screen one up, it's going to come up in the way of the thing, so I'm just going to do things the long way for now. So if I go to HHHHH, where was it now? So hard surface tools, you've got your flat one here, you've got a planar one over here. Planar's quite good for kind of like if you've got something at one level, you can literally just draw it all the way through. If you carve something into a surface that's flat and you kind of think, oh, actually I don't want that, you can go to the highest point of the flat surface, hold the alt button, and then draw across the bit you've just carved in, and it will kind of like level out the surface again. You still want to dynamesh it after that because you're going to have some horrible topology, but obviously you could always just click undo, but it depends when you actually did it. H polish, it's all alphabetical. I'm just losing my ability to spell and recount the alphabet at the moment. So is it under P for polish or is it under H for no, I've got too many tools here, I can't see it. It's there anyway. Use the H polish tool. I say press H when you've got the when you've got a keyboard connected, it should bring it up. So I'm just going to quickly give this, I'm not pressing very hard, I'm just going quite lightly across the surface, just kind of burnishing it off. Just trying to remove any kind of marks from the original polygons that were there. And if you come up to the top here, again, do the same thing, you'll see that the surface levels down. Now, with H polish, sometimes you can go a little bit too far. H is hard, sorry, it's a hard polish. So it does kind of like create a very flat surface. Now it'll annihilate the actual flat surface I'm working on, but it'll preserve the edges so you get a nice crisp edge. So as you're going around, you can see it's like sharpening it up nice, and it gives it a nice machine look. I'm just going to smooth that bit off the inside because I've got a few irregular kind of bits there that I don't like. And this bit here obviously is a little bit too thick at the moment, so I'll leave it in there for now, and possibly come back to that later on and just do a little bit of mashing up, change the details, possibly thin it down, we'll see where we go. And I'm just going to quickly just drop my clay build up tool on. I'm going to go to an inverted one, and I'm just going to drop the neck out a little bit, because obviously when we put this on the model, I don't want it to look just like it's big glob or something somebody's just dropped on. I'm going to have an actual ridged edge. Now I have purchased these orb crack brushes. If you haven't already got them, I can't remember where I got them from now, unfortunately. But if you search for just orb cracks, they are very good. There's two orb crack brushes in there. You get a whole orb pack. And they're very good. Like the damn standard tool over here is the one that comes with it by default. So if I was going to sculpt any kind of surface kind of contour and details, like if I was doing engraving on it, you can see obviously here it's pinched it down, but the edges are quite soft. And if I undo that and I go back to my orb cracks brush and I do the same thing, you can see it's not pinching it. And obviously if you're trying to do engraved detailing in armor, particularly if you're trying to put a lot of detail into a small area, the pinched edges are going to kind of cause you problems, so it's always better to use something like that. I mean, you don't need the oil brushes, you could use like the standard brush and just invert it, or even I've used damn standard and just changed the alpha on it before, because you have this tiny little pinhole alpha with like a you can see it over here, it's like a little dot there. If I just move my mouse up here like that, you can see the current alpha is that. If you change the alpha to something different, so you go for something like maybe like that, where it's a very small, concise dot. Again, if I just do that, you go for like that, you're going to get a much tighter cut. You go for something like that that's got barely any bleed on the outside, you'll get it even tighter still, without the kind of the dipped edges. Right, let's take these shoulders away now, because I'm not happy with them, I don't like the look of them. I'm going to go for my trim brush for this one now. So trim dynamic, there we go. Again, I've got it shortcutted, it's a standard brush, you will have this one if you're using said brush. Doesn't seem to be doing an awful lot here for some reason. Okay, I'm not sure what's going on with that. I'll leave that one. I'll just go back to clay build up, and I'll just remove it with clay build up. And you've got to be careful with clay build up not to go too intense. If I go really deep like that, and then I go like that, you end up with like real messy surfaces. If you go quite lightly with it, you can chip away gradually without kind of like mangling the surface too much. Obviously, you don't want to kind of completely destroy it. You've got to be careful what you're preserving and what you're okay, I've got a feeling I should have left them in actually. I'm just going to undo it a little bit. I just do this sometimes where you click on the wrong you click on the wrong thing and it just causes just makes it look messy and horrible. So I'm gonna leave them in. What I am gonna do, because I want a little bit of distance between his neck guard and the shoulder, so I'm just gonna bring the neck guard in like that, and then I'm gonna bring the shoulders out, and then I'm gonna have to I'm not gonna re-sculpt the boobs, but I will kind of deform them out. So, and again, just be careful to do it all as a, you know, small movements with the moves, or you can stretch everything really badly if you're not careful. So it's worth spend a little bit of time and get it right. I'm going to use a trim tool now, so it goes for trim curve, and I'm just going to take that down there. I'm just going to take the edge off. Now, with the trim tools, there's a couple of options for you. You've got trim, you've got clip, you've got slice. Slice will change the poly group, so you can isolate it by control click tapping it. It's not really what you want to be doing unless you've got a very specific reason to need to do that. Clip curve will basically take all of the polygons from the outside and just flatten them into that line there, so all the bit that I've just removed from there would just be flat. Now if the bit I've removed is wider, like if I cut it through here at the breasts, for example, cut it through this side of it, all of the bit that's here, from profile you'll actually still see the same outline. From the front you'll just see, obviously there's the, you know, it'll just be look like it's just been cut off. So be mindful of using the clip tool. There's places where that's the only thing that will work though, and you just have to go back in and do a bit of a tidy up afterwards. The trim curve tool literally just cuts it all off, and if you look at the poly group is put there, it's created like a new poly face, and it's all triangulated. And you know, I know people get into it saying it's, you know, you don't want triangles and all this kind of stuff. I actually don't care what I've got, because again, like I said, I'm going to dynamesh this before it's done again. So I'll show you the planar tool actually and see one of the benefits of this one. So if we go like that, this is all flat surface. It's going to basically pick up the flat surface and carry it through. Now I want to remove this kind of like nasty little bit, but I can't do it by, well, I can do it by doing that, but it's picked up the angle of where the tool was when I laid it down. I want to carry that line through. So I'm just going to hold Alt on the thing here, which gives me a negative, so it's going to raise everything up to this level. And you see as I go over it now, it's just going to bring it all up to this part. So I've now got a completely uniform area to work with. I'm just going to re-dynamesh it very quickly, just because I've got some nasty topology there I don't want to work with. And I'll put it back onto H polish and just give the outside of the arms a quick going round, just to correct the shape a little bit, polish it in. It's not a quick process, you know, and the more you do these kind of things, the speedier it gets. Obviously, once I've done this breastplate, I'll save this down as an OBJ file if anybody wants to use it in their models. Again, it'll be on the £10 pledge or the $10 pledge through Patreon. So, get on board, have a look, and we'll go. I think for this video, I'll get to the end of the breastplate so you can see what you're going to be getting, and then I will knock it on the head for this sculpt. I'm getting into 35 minutes already so far. I feel like I've kind of just waffled. So rather than drag this on for hours and hours and hours, I'm just going to kind of... Oh yeah, sorry. So I had symmetry on. I had a really nasty looking bit on this side. So I've corrected. This side hasn't auto corrected. The trim tool doesn't work with symmetry. So when you're using trim, always be mindful of this bit. So what I'm just going to do is go mirror and weld, and it'll take everything from this side and flip it over to that side. So now I've got another perfectly symmetrical model again. Mirror and weld is in one of the menus, and I forget which, because stupidly I've got a custom user interface because using the Cintiq and not having shortcut keys and stuff available, I found it easier to keep certain things available. I recommend actually you would do the same, just because obviously it's one of those things where you're going to want the things you use most regularly available to you, and because you can customize it, it's worth doing it. So that's going to be the base of the armor, or the breastplate. I'm just going to take the trim curve tool, and I'm just going to go up like that, and then I'm going to tap alt, which puts a curve in it, and I'm just going to draw it all the way through there. You see it's kind of taking it out now. If you look at it from the front, you can see it's not done it perfectly. It's left a bit of a bow in the middle. I'm not fussed about that because of this, but because of this being like hidden inside a model. Let me just quickly mirror that. I'll quickly do mirror and weld on it, so you can kind of like bring it through the other side. I'm not so fussed about the odd arching in the middle, the bowing, purely because, like I say, the torso is coming straight through this bit. You're not going to see it, so it doesn't really matter. But having said that, if you wanted to avoid that, this is when your clip curve comes in. Clip will give you a nice smooth curved surface. It won't obviously work perfectly necessarily. You might have to tidy up like the edges. You can come back in with a trim dynamic brush and kind of like break that down a little bit, but you know, it's down to how you want to do it really. I think I'm going to go Lion Theme on this rather than Dragon. I don't want to go full Final Fantasy on it and be a bit too copy liking. So I'm going to just kind of rough in some details. Just do a quick Dynamesh again. It's just masking the inner part of the shoulder here. So obviously it's going to be armor, you want a bit of thickness to it, so I'm not going to take the whole thing down. It's going to kind of like take a bit more off the outside edges around here. I'll tap once and I'll do it the other way just to sharpen it up and kind of, you know, tidy up any kind of like roughness on the edges. And then I'm just going to invert the mask, so these, I've got the lighter parts on the sides, and then we're going to move. I'm just going to do that on the side there, again holding shift just to lock it in. I'm just going to drag that inwards a little bit, so it's just going to create me a slight kind of recess. And again, I'm not fussed about kind of like, you know, making it hollow. I'm not fussed about saving topology or any of that kind of stuff that's a concern if you're doing modeling for games and stuff, because ultimately all of this stuff is going to get merged together into a single solid object. And although, like I say, you make it in separate pieces, you want to keep it like that until the death. And then when you're ready to 3D print, what I always do, again, rightly or wrongly, I don't know, I create a Dynamesh of all of the parts and merge everything back together. Obviously separate any parts that need to be 3D printed as separate objects. And just go through and just basically merge everything into a single object with Dynamesh. Now sometimes you have to have the poly count quite high on that, and your resolution needs to be high, but the benefit you get is, you know, you haven't got any like internal geometry, you know everything's all solid, and if you've got any like little piddly holes that are going to cause problems in the 3D printer, they'll get filled in by Dynamesh. You haven't got to worry about that. The downside, obviously, is if you have to come back and change something afterwards and you've dynameshed everything, you're going to kill your file. Now, one of the things I do a lot, which can be bad, so I've got on this at the moment 272 steps of undo history, which is basically like individual brush strokes I've done on it. I can undo this right back to the beginning, and I end up with like a sphere. So if I just click on this bar here, which I don't know if you can see properly or not, but I just drag that back, you'll see everything I've done just kind of undo itself and go back to the sphere. Now I don't want that, obviously, so I'll drag the bar to the other end. Every time you do this and you end up with undo history, the undo history is saved to the file. So if you're sculpting for like, you know, 8 hours on a figure, by the time you get to the end of it, you're going to have a lot of undo steps, and you're going to end up with a huge file. It's going to take a long time to load. So one of the things I do, and again, I'm not saying I recommend doing this, but if you're struggling with it, go to the file menu, and then, again, I don't think you can see it very well on the video there, but there's a little orange thing there. Orange is highlighted, basically, and it says undo history, and it's just under save as. If you take that off, then it won't save any of your undo history. Now, that means you're starting with this without the ability to undo anything. So everything I've done now, I can undo. The next time I load this file, I can only undo what I do from that point onwards. So before you save and shut down, you make sure you're happy with everything. There's nothing you want to change, otherwise you're going to scrap it and doing it again. There's always the ZBrush crash, which is a absolute nightmare situation. Always happens when you really don't want it to. And obviously, if you do get a crash on the system, there's not a lot you can do about it. You've got to kind of grin and bear it. So, do what you can to kind of avoid it, I suppose. Okay, I think I'm just going to go and put some plates and layers and stuff in. So I'm just going to go and get my oil crack brush. Again, I've still got symmetry on. What I'm drawing at the moment is only indications of plates. I'm just going to divide this once, so now up to 212,000 active points. But I want to kind of create a little I'm going to go for like a little now this isn't going to be the actual plate itself, this is just like an indication of where things are going, so I'm using this as like a pilot line, like a guideline for me. So that's going to be the where the collar's gonna go. So I'm just going to raise that bit up ever so slightly, and I'll stick a few rivets around here just to kind of like create it, make it looking nice. I'm going to put a cut all the way through the armor plate, all the way down this side. I won't bother going through the gap here, obviously. I'll just resume here. And again, like I say, if you try to do this with the damn standard brush, it'll work, but you really do need to change your alpha. Which is one of the good things about ZBrush, I suppose, is the customization options. I'm just going to do a couple of passes over these lines where I want them to show up, because we're talking about a miniature and 32mm, you've got to kind of get it out of your head that it's got to look really pretty on the screen. So if it looks photorealistic when you're sculpting it, it's not going to work in 32mm. Just to put it in context, like if you're wearing a belt at the moment and we shrink you down to a 32mm size, your belt is essentially going to disappear. You're not going to see it. It's just too small a detail. You need to sculpt the belt so it looks like it's about 2 to 3 inches thick on screen, and then when you 3D print it, then obviously it looks right. I found that out the hard way when I did the version 1 of my Barbarian. He's got quite a few straps around his chest, around his armour, and holding his boots on and stuff, and I didn't make them anywhere near thick enough. I mean, they were the equivalent of about an inch thick, so they were still quite thick, but you know, when you come to 3D print these things, it really does kind of show up all the flaws. So I'm just going to get my clay build up tool. It's going to come in here. And again, I'm only going rough. You can come in, you can do retopology if you really want to, because we're talking about hard surface armors. For fantasy figures, I'm inclined not to bother. Again, with a miniature, if you've got a slight surface imperfection or something's not quite right, you're not really going to see it. It's a bit more forgiving. You can get away with it. If you go 75mm for 54, you probably want to start considering your retopology as a serious option. But for where we're at here, I'm just going to quickly just scrub the surface over with the build-up tool. Change the view occasionally, so you don't want to start, and again, I'm going very lightly. yeah, move the views around, because you obviously see it from one angle. It's quite easy to lose your sense of where you're at in terms of depth. You know, your perception is kind of like all focused in one direction, and then you rotate around, you realise actually you've got big lumps and bumps and, you know, ugliness going on that you just don't want. Now, this isn't, you know, the surface is rough as on this. It's, you know, it's a real, you know, quick and nasty way of getting in, really. But, like I say, for the purposes I'm using, it does the job nicely. So all I'm going to do in a minute, I'm just going to dynamesh this down again. So just control and drag on the screen. Okay, so I'm just going to run a dynamesh on this now. So control click and control mouse, control click, drag out, and you can see, because I've got blur on and polish, it's kind of smoothed everything out. It's evened some of the bumps up, but it's also reduced the topology polygons back down to 52,000. I'm just going to divide that one more time again, and I'm going to put the damn standard on this time. I'm going to run around the perimeter of this to create a raised lip. Now I'll polish up to this afterwards, and this will create a nice sharp edge for the raised armor plate that I'm just making here. There we go. So I don't want it to be a lip, and at the moment it's a little bit kind of funky looking. It'd probably be alright if it was going to be cloth or something, but because it's going to be an armor surface, I'm going to hold Alt down, which works in a similar way to planar. So I've got my H polish on, I'm just going to go Alt, and it's going to basically just, rather than like flattening it down to bring up the level, to bring everything level, it's going to start raising the level. So you get the nice kind of polished surface, you get the nice hard surface look, and it maintains the kind of the height of the collar. And again, you know, if you're talking about a realistic look, everything at the moment is a little bit thick, a bit chunky. I'm going to turn the blur off, which is re-dynameshed it again anyway. In fact, that's kind of just done what I was going to do all the way around, to be fair, so I'm not overly worried about that. I will just quickly... so this is what I was saying about changing the views regularly as well. You see I've got this like weird kind of like bump. Again, on the miniature you probably won't see an awful lot of that, but I'm just going to kind of like polish down that corner bit there, just to create an even flow all the way through, really. And then here, I think we've got, it looks like a little kind of slight kick out on the armour. Yeah, you can kind of see there, we've got this like, this bit. Not overly worried, I think I will just quickly just push that in all the way around there. So just rotate gently, just push. You're going to end up with like these little kinks and stuff like that, because the tool beams are small, so you can kind of enlarge that if you need to. Right, I haven't got any there, I've got one here, yeah, so let's just correct that bit, and I'll just do another dynamesh. And you can see this line that I sculpted in here now, that's pretty much gone, so I'm going to have to redo that, but it's not the end of the world, I can live with it. I'm just going to run the polish tool just around the outside here, just to buff all this back in. Now if you don't want to kind of risk damaging and destroying the surface detail on the adjoining area, the bottom, down here, what you can do is mask it off first. I didn't bother. And again, rightly or wrongly, I'm not sure. I'm sure people have opinions on it, but I just decided to leave it as it was, and not fuss too much. So I'll do my divide again to get the count back up. I can avoid doing this divide thing every time by actually just changing the the Dynamess resolution. So divide it, it kind of doubles the resolution. So if I just double from 128 to 250 or something around there, that's probably going to do the job as well. So I'm just going to quickly just run this around the outside of the collar again, on the lower part of it, the armour side. So again, my thinking for this, I used to paint models a lot before I sculpted anything. So as a painter, I know a lot of people use ink washes and stuff to distinguish armour plates. A little groove like that around the definition between the armour will obviously help ink washes run in, and help to define where one armour plate stops and where the other one starts. So, you know, I'm thinking about it as a painter, I'm thinking about it as a sculptor, but most importantly, it's being thought about as a miniature all the way through. So at no point am I thinking, oh, this looks nice, let's turn it into a miniature. It's got to be sculpted for it. It just won't work the other way around. So you see, I am using the rotate tool rather than the rotate button, which obviously does the job. I am just clicking in the grey space and just move it around there, and it does the exact same job. I just find it a little bit quicker, because obviously rather than trying to find a button, I can just click to the nearest blank space. Sometimes if you've got like this kind of situation going on, there is no blank space, your only option is to use the button to navigate. But as soon as you're kind of like in a, you know, a kind of a, you've got a situation like this going on, it's worth bearing in mind. Right, so I've got the lines back in, I've got me detailing. I'm just going to up my Dynamesh resolution in case I have to redo it again. I'll leave polish on. So I'm fairly happy with that. That's doing my editing there. So I'm just going to come in and correct that a little bit, just put a bit of smoothing over it. That's not too bad there. And again, it's not, you know, it's not perfect, but if I zoom out to kind of that kind of scale, you know, that's kind of what you're going to be looking at when, you know, when you're dealing with a finished piece. So it's worth occasionally just drop it down to a point where, you know, you're going to be, you know, dealing with it. I have actually, just behind my monitor, I've got one of the figures I've sculpted previously, so this is going to be the same scale. So if I say, oh, this figure actually is available through the Patreon. I haven't finished painting him, so the paint jobs are way off done yet, but this is one of the 3D printed Patreon models. So if you want to get hold of him, and you know, he's been lovely to paint, even if I do say so myself. If you'd like to get hold of a copy of this model, then if you go onto my Patreon page, which I'll put in a link in the bottom below, the Patreon is $15, I believe, and gives you access to the 3D digital downloads. There's this one, and there's three other models, the Wizard, the Rogue, the Barbarian, which is him, and the Fighter. So all four of those models are available for you to download for a £15 pledge. And then you can go off and either put them out on your own 3D printer if you've got one, or you can send them off to a 3D printing bureau like Shapeways, or I know there's loads of them out there that do it now. I had this one done through Entrascan. They're a company based in the US, relatively cheap, I believe. I think from memory, I had five or six of him printed as competition giveaways through Facebook, and I think it was something in the region of about $7 to have one of these printed. So if you're talking 15, and he was more expensive because it goes on volume. He's a bigger model than the others. But he was about $7. I think the others came in at about $3 or $4 a piece. So you could probably get the full set printed for, you know, less than $20. I say the quality is, I mean, this is the quality. This isn't cast or I've done no finishing on this at all. This is like literally the model as he comes straight off the printer. All I've done is like pick the head and the arm selections I wanted for him. So, but yeah, get stuck in, have a look. You know, come back me, support me, and I'll keep producing for you. Obviously, by the time you see this, the Spear Maiden or Spear Master model should be finished as well. So you'll actually have five figures for your money. So yeah. Anyway, the point of this one was just The point of this one was just to show you the relative scale. So if I want to, you know, if I want to see what the thing's going to look like, if you've got a figure nearby, you can put it up on a screen. Obviously, it's going to be probably that big. You know, by the time it's printed and actually on a model. So, you know, it's worth having a figure nearby just to scale a frame of reference. Now, this model actually is on a 30mm wide base. The top point of the base here, this part across the top, the little recess, is around about 20mm. 20mm to 25. So, I'll measure it at some point and just double check. But I actually have... although I dropped that millimeter ruler straight into the screen earlier, which will be dropped alongside the model so I can check the scale. One of the other things I always do is I drop a 30mm base into the display as well, and that way I can put the base under the feet of the model, make sure that the base is 30mm according to the ruler, and then if the model's too small or too big, you scale it up or scale it down accordingly, and then you can kind of gauge what the model will look like when it's 3D printed and it's actually sitting on the appropriate size base. And obviously, if you're using a 25mm base instead of a 30mm base, you do that. If it's going to go on a 40mm base, you make sure it's 40mm and so on. So it's worth checking anyway. You'll see on all of my renders, they've all got a black base below the model. And that's exactly what that is. Basically, I've just got one base that I use, and I'll put that in one of the files at some point for you as well. I won't put Bobby Jackson's ruler in there because obviously it's not mine to give away. But what I will do is I'll build. I need a 100mm ruler now with some of the stuff I'll do. So I'll put a 100mm ruler together, and I'll put that in there as a digital download as well. So that'll be a kind of accessories pack for digital sculpts. Back to this one anyway. Yeah, so check the scale. I'm happy that I can see enough of that ridge that is, you know, it's going to do the job. If I wanted to make it larger, one of the things that you could do without having to kind of like, you know, redo all the surface and everything else, and I think I will just for the sake of kind of increasing a little bit of the depth on it. Just go around the masking the edges here. In fact, there's a number of different ways you could do it. I think what I'm going to do with this, I might actually separate it out. Just soften the mask by accident, which means it's not going to capture all the way to the edges. I'm just going to quickly whiz that round there. And let's go on the inside here. Now, separating this out is actually going to give me a little bit of flexibility in terms of how the whole thing kind of like is assembled, where it's positioned, and allow me to kind of do a bit more detail work on the bit below. So I'm going to take it off there. So you can see it's all masked up. Now I could polygroup it if I wanted to, but I'm not going to. It'll be a separate polygroup anyway, so go to my subtool menu on the right hand side, and then right at the very bottom, well, not right at the very bottom, about halfway down the menu chunk here, just below the delete button, which you do not want to press, you'll see split. If you click split and open it up, you've got group split, split to similar, split to parts, split on mask to split mask. Now I want to do split masked really, but it's greyed out at the moment, and the reason it's greyed out is because I divided the geometry. So what I need to do is I need to open up the geometry tab, and at the top you've got lower resolution, subdivision slider, and you've got delete lower. if I delete lower, that removes it. Basically, there is no subdivision on there now. It's just that is just what it is. And when I come back to split now, my split masked and split unmasked are actually both there still. So I'm just going to split mask points off. So now, as I come up here, I've got two subtools. So if I turn off that one, I'm left with this, which has got a great big hole in it. So first thing I'm going to do, I'm going to dynamesh it. Dynamesh it and close the holes anyway. But there is a close holes button, which I've put down here. But dynameshing does the same thing. So we're just going to take this bit that I don't need anyway. So I'm going to take some of that down. And then this stuff here, I'll just smooth off and I'll just round it off. It's not important because the other bit's going to fill the gap anyway, but let's just make the tool a little bit larger and then hold the up button down. We'll just go through. Now, dynameshing there, rather than closing the holes, the reason for doing that wasn't just because dynamesh is just quick and easy. The reason was because the topology of this bit now is also included as part of the dynamesh, whereas previously it would have been all funky triangles and stuff, which obviously you don't want. You just can't really sculpt on the funky triangles. It doesn't matter as a just as an actual filler surface. That's not a problem in the slightest. So I'm just going to come back over now with my H polish. I was going to go over the armour there. Now when I do the close holes on the other side, I am going to close holes on the other part of the armour. The reason for doing that, in my brain, is that closing the holes creates a new poly group. Now if you're not familiar with poly groups, I'll give you a very, very brief, very quick explanation of what they are. The poly group is have I got any on this? Okay, so every different colour on here, let me just take the poly frame off, but every different colour there is a different poly group. So every time I've done something, or if you take a shape that's got multiple sides, whatever, or an object's made with multiple tools. So if you remember, I put the breasts in by inserting a sphere. So the sphere was a new polygroup. Now, even though I've dynameshed it together, they're still separate. If I hold control and shift, and I get this tool come up, a little lasso thing, and I click on a polygroup, it isolates the polygroup entirely. So I can sculpt this without right up to the edges. I can do inflations and all sorts of things, even subdivides, and it'll affect only what's visible here. Now, if I click and drag, oh no, it doesn't work. You've got to select rectangle. If I click and drag, I've got the inverse of it. And if I just click again, holding that, then it puts everything back. It's obviously good in this case, not so much, because obviously these should all be one tool. But by the time you get to the point at the end of the end game where you're starting to insert like straps and buckles and rivets and all that kind of stuff, it's handy having the separate poly groups, just because when you if you decide you don't like the rivets, or you put the rivets in the wrong places or whatever else it is, rather than having to just start again or flatten them all down and whatever, you can actually go back and isolate the individual ones. You can delete hidden, so there's a little button I've got down here, it says delete hidden, and that's in one of the menus down here as well. I think it's the geometry menu, geometry modify topology. So if I scroll up here a bit so you can see some more what's going on, just below where you've got the dynamesh is here, you've got modify topology just two notches down, and you've got mirror and welds in there, delete hidden, weld points, close holes. There's quite a few. I don't use a lot of all of these. I've never used half of the options in here. I don't really know what they do yet, and I've got a bit of a play with them. But the ones I do use, like I say, I can vouch for. Delete hidden. Obviously, if I delete the breast, if I do that now, remove the breast, and then I click delete hidden, they're gone. But you're not getting them back. You then have to close the holes and then rebuild it and whatever else. So if you get to a point where you really don't like something you've done, you've got that option. It's quicker than kind of what trying to flatten them down and kind of get rid of them. So it's worth remembering. But like I say, if you insert boxes or spheres, or if you put rivets all over things and you don't like them, isolate them, remove them from the view using that, and then just click delete hidden and they're gone. Okay, so let's turn polyframes off. In fact, I'll turn polyframes on. I'm just going to auto group this now, so it's actually everything that's connected is all going back together. So that's there. I'll just run a little bit of a H polish through the neck hole here just to smooth it all off. Okay, so let's get my second tool up now. So I'll leave the poly tool thing activated. You can see this is slightly different now. So if I go to that, so this is blue, this is all one subtool. If I go to close holes, and then I'm just going to put it solo mode, I'll turn it upside down, you can see it's created this it's barely visible because of the colour differentiation, but if I do that now, I've got a different poly group, which I just click mask and then tap the bounding box once. And it's going to mask just that area off for me. Now when I come back out, I'm just going to invert that, and then I'm just going to do this. I'm just going to drag this down. Now what that's doing is creating more depth to the collar. So if I unsolo it, you can see it's done something a little bit funky. But what I'll do is I can drag that up now, and that creates the extra height that I was looking for. So it's basically done what I wanted it to do anyway. I'm just going to dynamesh that now, and then it's still two polygroups at the moment, but I'm just going to run around the perimeter. Now, worth noting here, because I have done a split from the main model, the settings for like mirror symmetry and all that kind of stuff, they're all turned on, activated still. If you do like an extract, a mesh extract, that's not necessarily going to be the case. So it is worth just being mindful of do you need to reactivate anything when you do it. Now I'm just dropping this bit down again because I noticed when I was looking at it before that it was not quite all in. Now I'm going to thin this out a little bit. And again, I can do this now without having to worry about the actual main mesh of the armour. There's going to be no kind of issues with that. Now if I want this collar to be if I want the collar to be used in the model and actually not have to fill the whole thing with like hair or the model's head, then what I'll need to do is just make sure that the head is a separate component, so the head will need to be printed and then inserted into like a neck socket. So again, that's just a little bit of I'll cover that later on in this tutorial anyway, but just burnishing off some of the bits where you can see the polygons. Okay, so if I uncheck solo now, come back to the model, you can see I've got this is protruding down a little bit too much. I'm just going to just take my move tool and just going to push that up, put it back in its place. At the back here, it's all connected, it's all in, so I'm just going to kind of like open up the neck, just smooth the inside out a little bit. Now the height of this might change. I may end up bringing the height down a fair bit, but for what it's worth, I'm fairly happy with that now. So I'm going to come onto this bit and polish this off, smooth it off a little bit, because I noticed there's a few angular bits in there that I didn't really want. Okay, so detailing the armour. So I'm going to go back into the solo mode for that. I'm going to get my orb crack brush again. make it fairly small. I was going to quickly just, oh, a bit bigger than that. I'm just going to quickly put that line back in. Now, I don't know if you can see my line wobbled a bit then, as I was doing it. one of the orb cracks brushes have actually got a smooth stroke feature. It's a lazy mouse enabled on it. Lazy mouse is great in some circumstances, but when you're trying to freehand and whatever else, it's not ideal, so I keep it turned off most of the time. I only tend to really use it if I've got to do something that's like, you know, really straight and flowing and curved and whatever else. If I'm just doing freehandy type details, then I'll if it's imperative that it's super straight, then I'll switch to the thing, but I tend to avoid it otherwise. Okay, so the next thing I want to do, I'm just going to put an impression in here. So obviously it needs some detail. It looks like a really naff kind of boob armour type thing at the moment, which isn't what I want. So I'm going to bring this down to about here. And then we'll go straight down to there. And I'm going to put a gorget in there. Gorget, whatever you call it, but big old neck guard. So, best way to do this then, I'm going to mask this bit out. And then I'll do a mesh extract. So I've not done that yet. I'll be doing a lot of these by the end of the model, by the way. But mesh extract is down here on the bottom of the subtool menu, and just click extract and you get this like little bit come up. Now I want a bit thicker than that. I want something that's like quite chunky to start with. Just does not seem to be thickening enough. Okay, that'll do. Looks ugly, but it'll do for now. So go accept, and I'll click it. And you can see I've got my polygroups and everything else on there. And I've got this horrible bit of artifacting going on here. So I'm just going to hold shift and just whiz around out. So I don't know why the polygroup's changing as I do this, but. It's not a polygroup, it's the mask. Ignore me. Okay, so two things I'm going to do on here. The first is I'm going to turn on symmetry. Second is I'm going to dynamesh it. So let's go for geometry, dynamesh, polish, project off, dynamesh. Okay, so now it's got edges are fairly sharp. Go back through and just H polish them up. That's quickly come down and buff that bit. This bit here is going to need a little bit of attention because it's a bit too thin, so I'm just going to polish it down. You see it's changing the shape of it, but I'm not overly concerned. Now what I'm going to do, I'm going to put my rotator there and then draw up. So I'll put it actually below the armour, just right there between the breasts on the main armour plate. And what I want to do is I'm going to hold, I've held shift as I drew it up, so it's actually gone in a straight line upwards. And I'm going to just do that with it. So it's actually rotated, so it's nearly, the bit here is nearly vertical. Hold shift again, draw it straight out in a front line, and I'm going to recess it back in. Now, you can see it's lined up into there quite nicely, and it's kind of protruding out from the sides a little bit more than I would like. So what I'm going to do now, go for the move tool, grab the sides, and then pull the sides back. It's going to be a little bit of crude shaping going on, but it'll do the job by the time it's done. Okay, so trim dynamic I'm going to turn on. It's going to come up here, and let's just dynamesh it again. I'm going to come up here, I'm just going to, why is my trim dynamic tool not working today? Okay, trim dynamic is usually a fantastic tool. You can normally rely on it to absolutely mangle the edges on these things, but it's just not working at all today. I'll log off and log back on later, and then when I come back on, it should be fine. In the meantime, we're going to do things the hard way, but such is ZBrush. Yeah, brilliant bit of kit, but it is a little bit temperamental at times, and it will just crap out on you and crash without any kind of like hint of a warning when you try to do something. So when you hit a point where you're kind of thinking, you know, oh, I'm quite happy where I'm at now, you save it. Speaking of, I haven't saved the entire time I've been doing this tutorial, so let me just quickly go to the file menu, save as, and obviously I want to put it into tutorials file. So I'll put it in here, Spearmaster Female, save. Okay, so now I've got this like this crusty looking rough armour plate. Oh crikey, what's going on here? Okay, I think I'm experiencing some malfunctions here, so I may have to kill it off and come back in a little bit. Or I might just terminate the video for now, because I've been running for around an hour and 20 minutes or thereabouts, so it's a long enough video at the moment. I would like to get the breastplate finished before I kill it. So just smooth off some of this, and bear in mind, obviously, you know, castability has got to be quite thick. It's got to go through 3D printing anyway, but it's also got to go through a moulding process to be produced in resin. So you can't have like paper thin resin, because that's just not good. And you know, from a moulding point of view, it's not going to work either. You've got to give them something to work with. So. I'm going to mesh that again. I think it's kind of getting there. I want it more curved, I think. I don't want it to be too angular. I'm going to kind of create that kind of thing. Bring that out as well. Okay, I think I'm fairly happy with that. I don't sound too certain. That's just me. Let's push the edges back into the bounding lines and set up that line work. Okay, so I'm just going to come around the outside again, just buff the edges with the H polish, make sure it's all nice and sharp and crisp. Okay, so that's too high. Let's take it from the bottom there. Hold shift as I go. I'm just gonna bring that down. Okay, that's better. That's much better. Yeah, I'm going to keep that, and then I will extend this bit up, I think, where I've masked it, and that's going to create the base plate for it again. So I'll merge them two together, and then just split on mast. so that's been dynamished now. The body can get dynamished again. So solo that. Now you can see where this was a poly group, where the border was. I've got all these jagged, horrible edges. So I'm just going to hold the smooth tool and just go through and just buff them back into the body of the plate. Now I haven't got much thickness at this point, so that's going to give me a problem. So what I'm going to put back face mask on, which again it's in the masking thing. That's another one of these ones that I use I use quite often. If you don't use back face mask, and as you sculpt on something, the back of the model hollows out. You need to be turning back face mask on. It's not a great way of kind of explaining it, but if I turn it off, and I'll see if I can show you. So if I go like that on here, you see I'm sculpting down, but then you can see it's affected the bottom of the model there. If back face mask's on, then it won't do that. Now, usually with back face mask, it's the other way around. So if I turn the intensity right up on this and I go right there like that, no, it hasn't gone, it's not enough. Here, there, right, so you've got that little hollow that's been created where like the tool basically, the intensity of the tool has pulled the bottom of the model up. And obviously you don't want that, so you've got a couple of options. You've got the inflate brush, is always, you know, a reasonable one to use. It'll create extra depth to it. It will deform the surface a little bit, so you want to use it maybe on the bottom end, where you're not going to see it so much. And then obviously with dynamesh it obviously every so often, just to make sure you're on point with it. Now what I've got here, I don't want this bit at the top, so I'm just going to trim curve that. I'm just going to take that straight off there, and that's not needed. And I'll just use the move tools just to bring the rest of the polygons in. And I want that coming right up to the edge there. So I'm fairly happy with the position of that. I will drag that down just to equalise the distance around here. But other than that, I'm going to get back to my isolated tool. I'm just going to H polish the surface, and then I'm going to H polish the edges down here as well. So this is all, it's all being sharpened up nicely. You can see obviously it's maintaining the edges really well. Don't really need to do the bottom here because nobody's going to see it, but yeah, I'll stop now because it's pointless. There you go. So you can see obviously it's done the plate I wanted. The bit here I just need to adjust is where it kind of blends into the other one, so I'm just going to buff that back down there. Use the move tool just to, I think that needs to come up that way a little bit. Just put it back on, just give it a little bit of a buff back. Okay, so fairly happy with that now. But now this collar needs adjusting because the everything's a bit uneven, so I'm going to bring that down to there. So I want to try and follow the same line. So that is going to come to there, I think. Dynamesh it again, just to make sure I'm not using stretch geometry when I'm doing this, and then I'll just create the shapes again. If you want to change tools, quick way of doing it is to control click. So, sorry, alt click. So, But for now, I've got this one active. I'm going to change back to that, hold Alt, click on it. Make sure that your tool is entirely, your brush is completely centered on it. And then you're good to go. Saves you having to click between the subtool menu all the time. Not that it's a particularly painful ordeal to do that, but you know, every little helps when you're trying to speed up your workflows. Right, now usually it will say something like this torso. I would have at least a portion of this pre-sculpted from like other figures I've done. So I wouldn't have started totally from scratch. Well, speed on this one, we come to do the head. I may use one of my pre-sculpted female heads. Just because obviously I think I might save the head sculpt for a separate tutorial somewhere down the line, rather than kind of throw it all in here. Okay, so gorg, it's done. It's in line with the lion armor now. So in line with the breast armor. I'm just going to polish these bits down where it's a little bit, I say, ugly, and you know, soften them down with the smooth brush, and then just buff them in with the polish brush. Don't forget to alternate between normal polish and then the H polish normal and then H polish inverted, and then just auto group it again, and that'll just bridge it up. Now you see we've got this little hole type thing going on. I'm just going to click close holes, and that'll kind of get rid of them. Sometimes when you dynamesh things, you end up with that going on. Usually where there's like a thin part of the mesh, you get holes and stuff. And it's not a very, you know, pretty thing to be happening. And it doesn't make your mesh unusable. So you've got to make sure you address it if it happens. You've got to deal with it, okay? So you don't want to have something like that kind of hanging around. Okay, so that's where we're at the moment. So we've got the gorget here, which I'll put a few kind of like little rivets around here. The neck collar, I'll put a few rivets around there as well, maybe. And again, I'm going for core points on this. I'm not going for, you know, functionality. I don't really care if it would be riveted there or not in reality. Do you know what I mean? It's a fantasy model at the end of the day. And yeah, you can get, you know, all hung up on whether or not something is 100% accurate, or would it be like that, what's the actual functional purpose of it. But you know, get in and enjoy what you're doing, you know, enjoy the sculpting process, and you know, enjoy it for what it is. Don't overthink it. Okay, I'm going to call that done there. Only thing I think I might do remaining, I'm going to put some straps here across this thing. So I'll put like a single buckle through there. That will give it something to actually fix the armour plate on with. The back I think I'm going to leave plain. And then the breasts aren't sitting right with me. I'm not keen on the way they're looking, so what I might do is I might create a little bit of a kind of a layered effect with the ore cracks. So we'll come back in again, we'll go so we've got quite a pointy type thing going on. We've got, like, you know, a couple of sharp edges, quite crisp and clean, so I don't want to kind of deviate from that kind of pattern. Let's go for, here we go. Okay, yeah, so I'm going to stick with that. And then what to do about this bit? Maybe put something in there. Put a little bit of detail in that little part. Maybe a little lion head. Lion head? Does that look weird? Yeah, definitely don't want no roaring lions here. That's just going to look crazy. No. Maybe I'll leave the lion details off for now. Should I have bought anything like that, maybe? Maybe I should have done that. No, not loving that. Let's take that away. Couple of undos. As I say, you'll find our concept a little bit on the fly and it'll all come together in the end. Don't really know what to do with that at the moment. I'll come back to that, I think. Okay, let's just get a strapping on the side there, and then I'll show you one of the tools I've created for the for the Patreon. It's in the Patreon, but it's not for it. It was for me because I needed something to. Well, I'm using it all the time, so I thought I'd actually create it and use it. You do a lot of undoing and then try and like go back onto doing sculpting. It reminds you that you know you're not working on the current version of the history. Just a safeguard, just make sure you don't start sculpting and lose something you actually wanted to keep. But in this case, I'm happy to go with it. Okay, so if I go to insert, and I want insert cube. I'm just going to drop it right there, and I'll hold shift to make sure it goes on straight, and then I'm going to go to my move tool, which is transpose move, not the move brush. So, and with this, hold shift, click in the corner, drag it straight up again, and I want to kind of reduce the thickness of the strap down, and then I'm going to take it and I'm going to drag it out that way as well. Now this, at the moment, is, I'll put the poly frame on. You can see it's not a great mesh. So what I need to do is, while this is the only thing selected, I'm going to split them off. So I'm just going to split unmasked. Split masked, which puts it back to this now. And then I need to dynamesh it. So I'm just going to do a quick polish turned on, project turned off, blur off, and I'm just going to dynamesh it. And that's going to give me a surface to work with, and I'm going to just grab the move brush on it at the bottom end. I'm just going to kind of like pull it out like that, so it's a little bit more following the contour of the model. And you can see obviously the shape of it's not right, position's not right, so what we'll do is I'll click on the corner there, drag it straight down, I'm just going to rotate it back in. Okay, that's kind of lining it up. That's where I want it to be. It's a little bit thicker than I need, so I'm just going to drop it back in again. And again, don't forget, you know, it might look a little bit chunky and crass, but you need it to kind of look like that. And I'm just going to go in there, and I'm going to select an empty tool, which is that one for now. And I'm going to go to import, and I've got my sculpt library, and I've got a tool called Buckle. Now, Buckle I've actually, let's say, saved, and it's a simple thing, but it's just that, but it works quite nicely. So, and again, you'll need to decimate that down. You'll need to subdivide that before you actually use it, but for now, that'll do the job. I think these straps might be a little bit too wide, so I'm just going to kind of use the transpose move again. I'm just going to thin them down a little bit. And then I'll just go to subtool, append. I'm just going to find my buckle tool that I've just loaded in, and it's going to be somewhere in the, there it is, right at the bottom. So alt click, move, and I'm over that side, and then I'm going to mirror it because it's facing the wrong way. So I'm just going to quickly rotate him around using the transpose tools, and I want to line it up with the strap I've just used, or the strap I've just created rather. And you know, just play with it until you get it right. You'll get it eventually. Now the strap that's going through is obviously supposed to be the same size as the strap that's coming out of the back of the buckle, so just enlarge it until the two are the same, and now your buckle's the right size for the model. Now I'm just going to drag that through, position it so it's in the right place, and then I think it just needs a little bit of rotation. Now I don't want to rotate it massively, so I'm just going to draw the line through the middle of the buckle, grab the center, the center handle, and then move it up and down, and that rotates it on that around the line I've drawn. And you just want to make sure that the buckle is pretty much even thickness on both of the sides of the line, and that the strap is protruding out. And I'm fairly happy with that. I'll say from the front it looks quite chunky, but I'm okay with that. And then I'm just going to mirror and weld so you get it on both sides. Okay, so there we go. We've got a little strap on the armour. Now the last thing to do is just the holes are going to carry on through the strap. So I'm just going to go to my clay build-up tool. Hopefully I've got the resolution to do this nicely, but if not, we'll just change it. But there we go. So one, two. There we go. Okay, so there's the strap done for the armour. And he's put a little fixing on this end, so it's actually attached to the armour plate, and another one at the back end here. So that'll just be another little insert cube. So go back to insert cube here. Bush. And I don't quite like the way that's gone actually, I might leave that as it is. And bush. There we go. Now because I've got this obviously here, and it's blue where everything else is grey, these have come in as a separate polygroup because they're inserted. So what we'll do again is I'll take it from there to there because I want it to move across that plane. And what I'll do, I'll just move the end of the end of the strap so it goes into the fixing. Just gotta be careful not to deform the strap too much. And that one's pretty fine. I'm happy with that one. Only thing I just need to do on him is to make sure that the okay. Oh, there we go. So we've got a little strap on the side of the armour. We'll do a few little rivets and then I'm going to call this done. So what I'm going to do is mesh insert dot. I'm going to set the rivet size down, or the brush size down rather, to 15. Now if you hold control down as you draw the rivets out, it will fix them at a certain size. And I'm going to go to maybe 19 for these, because I want them to actually be visible on the model. 19 I think is a decent size. So go to the start one, the end one, and put one between. And then we'll go to the center point and we'll put one there as well. And I'm just going to go around this one. I'm going to go one. Two. I'm going to go three on the corner. I'll space them out about there, about there, about there, 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 and then there. Okay, so actually the last one's the spacing's a little bit out, so let's get that centre one in. And we'll go to over there and then there. Now that's out. Okay, what I'm going to do, I'm going to auto group and then that one. Delete hidden on them. Okay, I'm relatively comfortable with that. Spacing's not perfect, but it'll do. Okay, so I'm definitely going to come back and do something here, because I still don't like the boo plate. But otherwise, I'm going to call that one done. So what we'll do now is we're going to merge all of these tools down, because if I don't merge them all down, I can't use them. Clarify that. I can't import the whole model into the main figure, which is obviously what we want to do. So I'm going to then come back to my skin Z sphere, which is the one we did earlier on, if you remember. I'm going to turn polyframe off on that. Now I'm going to go and append. So append breastplate. Okay, now let's just clear the masking on it. And obviously it's back to front, so I'm going to go mirror Z, and I'll turn it round, and then I'm going to scale. Now symmetry's turned on here. It's a good idea to turn it off. If you turn it on, you're relying on the position of the handle to determine where your symmetry falls, and if your handles are in the wrong place, you end up with a horrible line in the middle of it where it's scaled it across, and it's not really worked very well. There's a little bit of unevenness going on. It just looks messy and horrible. So this is now just kind of like a little bit of positioning. So, go with your mannequin. It's like dressing a doll, really, I suppose. Okay, I'm not. I need to rotate it a little bit. What's wrong? So you can adjust this anytime. It hasn't got to be perfect right now, but yeah, the more you get right now, the less messing around you got later on. That's what I was getting to do. And we have a backward tilt, and I'm quite comfortable with that. I think that fits all right. One thing I do need to do though on the armour, and again, you can't really tell if you do it the way I've just done, where you do it in isolation from the actual model, but the rear part of the armour is a little bit on the broad side at the bottom. I should have turned it down and thinned it, but you know, didn't. So I'm just going to do a little bit of, you know, fine tuning and tweaking and adjusting. I don't want to move it too much because it's going to screw up all the geometry if I do. But I am, I'm fairly happy with that. Okay, now as I say, I've not done a great deal in on balance. You know, we've now got a female spear warrior with an armoured breastplate. There'll be pauldrons, greaves, boots, gauntlets, and probably a bit of like bit of leather type material work going on. Maybe some like chainmail type stuff. We'll see how see what I fancy when I'm working through. But in essence, I'm going to call this one done. Just over an hour and a half now on the video. So yeah, thanks for tuning in. Thanks for watching. If you've got any questions or you want information about any more steps in the progress or any clarification on what I've already covered, post some comments. And otherwise, I'll be back for another part later to cover the next part of this model. Thanks so much, and I say you can get this and the component parts through through my Patreon, which is linked below. Cheers.